Division II National Showcase rolls along from Point Loma, California, just outside San Diego, for Azusa Pacific and the Sea Lions of Point Loma. It is game two of our doubleheader today, scheduled for seven innings. Game one went to Point Loma, rallying for five unanswered runs for a 5-4 victory in game one. Alongside Dimitri Young, the former big leader, Darren Goldwater with you. Dimitri, what do you take from the first game that can carry over into the second game if you're out there here for this doubleheader and the final game of the regular season?
Well, watching how Point Loma came back from that first game down 4-0, and they didn't quit. They scratched and clawed. They had guys in scoring position, and some of them they got in, but they got that key hit from Palos in the first game to put them ahead, and that momentum should carry over to the second game. But I don't think that Azusa Pacific are going to exactly just lie down and play dead for them either. So it's going to be a good battle this game.
Zach Knoll out there on the hill actually began his career at Oregon. Appeared in 15 games for the Ducks. More strikeouts than he had innings pitched. And the 215-pound junior here goes to work against one of the most prolific power hitters at the D2 level here, Colby Klez. If you missed it in the first game, we gave you all the numbers for Klez. He's got 22 home runs, which ties him for the most at the D2 level. The team has the most home runs at the Division II level. They came into the day with 82. They slugged two of them in the top of the first in game one and had a 4-0 lead through 2.5, but then got blanked the rest of the way. And Knoll gets them looking here to begin game two.
Ooh, crafty lefty busted him in two times with two strikes that he was not looking for, and he didn't even bite at him. But when you have 22 home runs, they're not going to give you anything to hit. So you got to take full advantage of when you do see a pitch that you can hit.
Toveline, who stands in there now, hit one of the solo home runs in the first inning. But that was a very different dynamic back then at noon local time. Since then, the wind has picked up, blowing in considerably off the Pacific Ocean.
Does not feel like Southern California at all.
No, it does not. Toveline on a line, and a diving grab is made. Balliet, out number two.
Made a diving play in the first game, made one in this one.
Number 16, Griffin Herrera.
So quickly, two up and two down here.
Look, great play. He's in position, and I bet you he always had a dirty uniform going home. His parents used to just make him get undressed in the car, or out before he gets in the car.
How about this? An eight-pitch first right here. That's the way to get game two underway. 1-2-3 on 9 pitches, we should say, for Zach Knoll. To the bottom half of the first we go here. Game two with this doubleheader between PacWest rivals.
There's a mountain here before me, and I'm gonna climb it with strength not my own. And he's gonna meet me where the mountain beats me and carry me through, and carry me through, yeah.
Initially, I was working as a substitute teacher because I needed the job. It was the feeling I got in my heart when I ran into students and they keep me updated about their lives. That was the aha moment to me. I am pursuing my counseling credential because I wanted to be part of that student growth. Through my master's program, I've learned about empathy and building those individual relationships. It's because the high level of education that I'm receiving, I see the value that I'm bringing back to my community.
Thank you.
Top of the lineup here for Point Loma is Travis Takata. Takata had a nice day for game one. So we'll give you the lineup here. Takata is the DH here for game two. The shortstop is Miguel Cazares. Center field and the preseason Division II player of the year, Michael Pries, bats third. Cleanup hitter is the first baseman, Justin Ledgerwood. Brett O'Toole hits fifth in left. Third baseman behind him, Colby Canashiro. Balliet in right field, who just made that diving grab. Casey Dunlap batting eighth. He's the second baseman. And Palos is the catcher, batting ninth. And easily the player of the game in game number one from that nine hole. There's Declan Kearney. Solid numbers here for Kearney. 6-0 in 15 starts. He stands 6'2", 170 pounds out of Las Vegas. Just a sophomore. And Kearney, just like Noel, also began his career at the University of Oregon.
Is that right? Is that what I talked about earlier, going D1 and finding out your playing time is not going to be what you planned, and so you go to a place where you're able to grow and shine as a ball player?
It's amazing how that works sometimes, isn't it?
Oh, it's absolutely beautiful. Because that's the first sign of being introduced to the real world when you break away from your parents. You know, you're going to find out that people are going to say this and that just to get you to the school, and then you find yourself sitting there, and what are you going to do? Are you going to be the type that, hey, I'm playing D1 and sit on the bench for 3 years and your career ends? Or you humble yourself and go like, okay, does this place have my major, what I'm looking for, as well as I'm going to be the man here? And obviously those numbers look good, 6-0 and have 45 Ks in 51 innings.
But it's a five-pitch walk to begin the bottom half of the first.
Shortstop number 10, Miguel Cazares.
From a region standpoint, Azusa Pacific right now is number 2 in the West region, but pretty much assured of a hosting spot, one of the two hosts of the West regionals. That's their expectation. Point Loma still has some work to do, and this is really the last chance they get to improve their body of work. This is the regular season finale. They had their senior day, 10 seniors on this team. And they honored them in between games of this doubleheader. And they are not assured of getting into the NCAA tournament, but beating the 10th ranked team in the country twice today would certainly help them out here. Meanwhile, Kearney struggling with his control. He's 2-0 here on the second hitter.
And see, I was going to say the opposite. Canizares is having a great at-bat. And he had great at-bats in the last game, and that should continue if winning is what they're trying to do. And that was an inside pitch. It looked a little in, but, you know, different umpires are going to have different zones.
Bill Barnes is behind the plate. Three-man crew is Anthony Formando at first and Ron Reagan at third. Cazares lays off ball three.
So we have President Reagan at third?
We do. He goes by Ron, however, not Ronald.
Or Ronnie?
I don't know. We can go ask him. There he is right now by the second base bag as the umpires have to move around a little bit more than at the professional ranks with just the three-man crew.
Now, did you see that 3-2 swing right there?
Good cut.
Yes, that wasn't a protective swing. That's I'm trying to do damage.
Takata off of first. That's a slow roller out to second. Choir to get the lead runner, and that is all they'll get. So there's one away for Micah Priest.
So that was a 3-2 off-speed pitch right there.
Center fielder number 21, Micah Pries.
Pries went 0-for-3 in the first game.
Did he have a hitting streak coming into this game or into the last game?
There was not one of note that I had jotted down. But he does have a whole bunch of home runs, and he gets into this one, but the wind's going to keep it in the park. A deep fly out to Klez, and there are two away.
That's the wrong time to hit the ball to that area.
And those are the two prolific power hitters in this game. Azusa Pacific has a couple other guys on their roster with some pop. But Klez, who made that catch, has 22 homers, and Preece, who flew out, has 30 in his career, 18 on the year.
You know what? I can see what all the buzz is about with Preece. That is an absolutely picture-perfect smooth swing, comparable to me with Sean Green or John Olerud.
Olerud was one of the prettiest left-handed swings.
Yes, it was.
You know who else was one that I just couldn't stop watching, you know, kind of growing up and watching the game, was Chipper from the left side. I don't know what it was about from the left side more than the right, but from the left.
Yeah, he did have a smooth stroke. It was like effortless.
Uh-huh.
The right side, it looked like, the left side, it was just very fluid. Almost, I mean, he looks like he's half asleep anyway.
Chipper Jones, of course. Meanwhile, that's Demetri Young. 13-year big league career. I'm Darren Goldwater. This is the eighth game that these two teams have played against each other this year. There was a four-game series early in the year that was non-conference that Point Loma took 3 out of 4. It's a strike to Ledgerwood. And then this series started yesterday with a doubleheader at Azusa Pacific, which is in the L.A. area. Popped up back a second. Kier in a triangle gives way.
Great job.
And the inning is over.
I'm a PacWest athlete.
I get to travel all over the West Coast.
I'm a PacWest athlete.
So I can excel in the classroom. I'm a PacWest athlete because I want to
win championships.
With students from countries all over the world.
From Australia to England.
We are diverse.
With majors ranging from business to fashion design.
Medicine to animation, we are scholars.
With players from every sport, from baseball to tennis.
Cross country to soccer to golf.
We are athletes.
Being a champion takes more than talent, more than the perfect pass, more than using your head. Being a champion takes the spirit to always push harder, the ability to overcome any hurdle, and the fire to be the best. Welcome to Division II, where the pursuit is yours to create. And the question isn't, can you do it? It's, will you?
Pretty easy, smooth first inning for Zach Knoll.
Beating off the top of a second for the
so he's got 4, 5, and 6 coming up. Check out these numbers. He's 8-2 with a 333, and he has 60 more walks, strikeouts than he does walks. It's the second time that he is facing Azusa Pacific. He beat him back on March 8th. 7 innings, 8 strikeouts, 1 run.
This guy's the real workhorse of the team right here. 8-2, 83 strikeouts to lead the team in 70 innings.
Gomez goes up there hacking. The only thing about it is that 8-2 record of his used to be 8-0. And then his last start against Fresno Pacific at their place only lasted 4 innings. And then against Hawaii Hilo, he took the loss in his most recent outing. In 5 innings of work.
So you're saying he needs this right here?
I think the team needs it. They need it from him today. Get one more win, feel a little bit better about themselves and their shot at getting selected for the NCAA tournament. Twice he's had double-digit strikeouts this year, including a 14-strikeout game. Gomez almost takes his head off and singles to begin the second.
Another great at bat from Justin Gomez right there, and lefty on lefty right there.
Batting fifth. The first base
stayed short. His swing was short. Nice load right there. Hands directly to the ball on playing with it. Almost took his head off. Can't be splitting wigs right now. You know, you might get a rally going, not slow down the momentum.
Gomez has now been on five times today. Had a heck of a day in game one, even though Point Loma came back to win that one, scoring five unanswered runs after they trailed it 4-0 through 2.5. Talented freshman here, Robles, is at the plate for an Azusa Pacific team that wrapped up its third consecutive PacWest championship in their previous series. Wrapped it up pretty early. And have won 25 of their last 28 games.
I'm just checking out Robles' his stance and approach up there to the plate. Yeah, he got that off the end right there. But love his approach up there at the plate. He looked like he's gonna be doing big things the next couple of years here, especially having the opportunity to start and excel. Right there, he's just a little out in front, got it off the end. It happens.
So the only base runner of the game to this point is quickly erased, and there are two away now for Will Stroud, who made an appearance late in game one as a pinch hitter and then stayed out there in right field. If you missed the conversation in the first game of this doubleheader when these teams met in early March, Azusa Pacific was 11-9. This is after the first three games of the series that were all won by Point Loma. And the Cougars were 11-9. Then they won 25 of their next 27 games until they lost game one of this doubleheader about an hour ago.
Having a nice at bat right there, Will Stroud is. And for those that normally don't start every day, and when you get an opportunity to get in there and play, things can go so many different ways. Because one, I want to get hits so I can stay in the lineup. And then, number two, now if I take too many and I make an out, I'm not going to get back in the lineup. So you can't really worry about that. When you get in there and play, you go and play your game.
And the freshman is hitting in front of the team captain and the four-year starter, Michael Goudreau. Slid up a spot or two in the lineup for game two.
Is it customary to lead that hole that big? I mean, both teams have done it today. Where you have a big hole between first and second, regardless of how many outs.
It is surprising how often we've seen it today.
I mean, granted, they got outs up the middle, but I've also seen balls going up in the hole that if they were playing in their spots, they get to.
Goudreau sends it back into the screen.
But would that go back to the analytics and possibly overcoaching, so to speak? Like being meticulous on every swing, every pitch, every count on where guys have to move. It should just be a general area. Move a little to the right, a little to the left.
Here's the 1-2 now, and Goudreau lines a one-hopper right at the second baseman, Dunlop. So a couple of guys reach, one's left. Inning and a half in the books here in your D2 showcase.
We can stop to make sure someone is okay.
Get in the way and disrupt the situation.
Notify an authority.
Or walk them home safely.
We can change the language around rape.
We can make campuses safer for our teammates, our friends, and our classmates.
We cannot be bystanders.
Taking action isn't always easy, but it's on us
to intervene.
Because we can.
Learn more and take the pledge at itsonus.org.
On my team, I thrive to work as hard as I can. I mean, whatever you do on the field, there's a positive correlation to whatever else you do, be it personal relationships, homework, the way you carry yourself. I've changed since I got to King University. It's really helped me to develop as a leader. I think it's honestly the best thing that's ever happened.
Justin James back to lead his alma mater. After 2 years as the UCSD pitching coach, he is back here where he had a long stint as an assistant previously. And now, after picking up a big win in game one, trying to squeak one out here in game two, and at least feel better about himself, even though knowing everything is out of their hands and out of their control in terms of whether or not they'll get an at-large berth. His left fielder, Brett O'Toole, comes up there with a huge swing, and it's nothing and one.
Well, can you blame him for swinging like that, the way that he swung the bat the first game? Just missing a grand slam, getting key hits. He's feeling good about himself.
When that started, when he almost hit that grand slam, that was kind of just as the wind had flipped around. But he knew it. His reaction was pretty clear that he knew that he didn't get it, even though that ball went all the way to the track and left.
Well, when you don't hit home runs and you hit the ball in the air, he pretty much knew it was an out.
It's just a given, right? Kearney gets another fastball by him. It's 2-2.
That was a nice hack right there. I mean, he swung through it, but you have three to play with. A lot of times you know, and people are in little league and high school, they tell guys to, you know, shorten up your swing, watch the ball. I like to keep it positive for the hitters, you know. Hey, you got two more to play with. Hey, swing that bat. Let's go. Try that ball. Instead of telling them what they're doing wrong up there, because as a hitter, you're already trying not to think, and now you're putting something in their head. Now they're thinking.
It's kind of like golf in that respect. If you're standing over the ball, you got thoughts going through your head, you can pretty much guarantee it's not going where you want. Count runs full now on O'Toole. Stays alive again.
He's swinging a good bat today. I don't know why it would stop now.
He was 1-for-2 in that first game, had a run scored. And he earns himself a leadoff walk here in the second.
Now batting.
And that's exactly what you want when you're playing for your life right now, as they say.
You know what I appreciate about these guys? All the close-ups when they're on first. Look at these grins, both of them. Robles, the freshman first baseman. O'Toole. We saw it throughout the first game also. A lot of just kid-like enjoyment playing the game.
Well, with travel ball the way it is nowadays, I'm pretty sure most guys know each other. Regardless of what school they go to, if it's in Southern California, Somewhere down the road, they played against each other, or they played on the same travel ball team, or they've been to the same showcase. So a lot of these guys probably know each other, and, you know, they're all buddy-buddy. Not like the old days when they talk about no fraternization and stuff. It was like, okay. But nowadays, I mean, there's just so much intermingling. You know, that fraternization has just kind of gone out the window.
O'Toole's got his lead as Kenshiro takes strike two. Bill Barnes, I think, thought it was a strikeout, and you could see him right there. All right, my bad.
Hey, we got a trigger happy umpire right here.
Got him for strike two.
Da, 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 da. Not top 10 right there.
Kenshiro in the air to left. Herrera now coming in pretty hard after the first few steps back. There is one away.
Now he just got under that ball, but I don't think the ball would have done anything with the way that this wind is blowing. I mean, you can look at the trees, and they're not going to show anything, no real indication, but sitting where we're sitting, it's cold.
We are on the third base side of home plate on the concourse, and that is right where the wind is blowing, right down from the left field wall back towards the plate. So he hit that into the teeth of the wind.
Ooh, that's a nice hack right there.
Baliette. So here's where we are. And this tent, it even got windy enough that this tent almost blew over on us in game number one. My buddy here is freezing. He's from California. Or at least you live here now.
Well, for the
last... I'm cold, too.
How are you cold? Aren't you used to this?
I live in Charleston. It's pretty warm down there.
How are your winters?
Well, if it gets below 50, then people will complain. And if it snows, then the world ends.
That sounds a lot like Southern California. You wouldn't think you're in California when you look at the overcast and people all bundled up.
No, but if you look out over the fence and see the Pacific Ocean, you'll get the idea then. Baliette strikes out here on three pitches.
Now batting.
This ballpark here, Carol B. Land Stadium, has been dubbed America's most scenic ballpark. For that reason right there, there's no room behind the fence before there's a cliff and then the ocean.
What a beautiful ocean it is.
Casey Dunlap twists it foul. A lot of youngsters going scrambling after that one. You know, if you played it right today, you could have caught the Padres game, which was 12:40 local time, and then come here to catch game two of this doubleheader.
I don't think anybody's coming here after they go to a Padres game. They probably had enough baseball for the day.
Especially if it's as cool over there. Off the edge of the bat, slow roller. And the inning is over. Goudreau handles that 6-4, and we're scoreless through two.
Baseball for me just kind of was the glue that kept my family together, I feel like. I don't know what it was that drew me in, but after I started playing for a while and started seeing some early success as a little kid, to see how much it meant to my parents to see me play the game and try to make a difference was really what fueled me to keep playing and stay competitive. Being a triple major is not necessarily easy, but at the same time, it is what you make it. Being a tighter-knit university, I have a lot of classes with the same professors, so they know me pretty well. I think it's that personal relationship that really helped me to thrive as a student. I was able to come here and get my triple major, as well as play a super high level of baseball against some of the best players in the country. There's a lot of options here in Division II with a lot of great ball players and a lot of great people, and they make sure that they give you every opportunity to succeed on and off the field.
That's how close we are to the beach. Lovely out here. A little cool today. Division II National Showcase moves to the third. This telecast presented by the NCAA Division II President's Council. Welcome to NCAA Division II, where the pursuit of excellence is yours to create. In Division II, student-athletes excel academically, athletically, and in the community for life after graduation. The opportunities are endless. Make it yours. Strong two innings thus far for Noel. He's given up one hit. He's got a strikeout and a walk. Nobody's been past first. 19, Joe Quire. And here's Quire. Quire's been the starting second baseman for the majority of the year. Started more than 20 games for him last year as well.
Nice bender for strike one from the lefty. I'm just looking at this young man and the approach that I would have against Mr. Noel, as a right-handed hitter.
He went.
I would crowd the plate and double dog dare him to throw me in. I mean, that was my approach against a pitcher like Noel, who likes to bust you in and then try and flail away with some soft stuff.
Here's his 0-2. That's a big sweeping curve for his second strikeout of the day.
And that's probably what Quire's going to see all day until he makes the adjustment.
Now batting, the catcher number 8, Aaron Roos.
Today's Aaron Roos. He didn't play in game 1. He's getting the start behind the plate in the second game of the doubleheader, which, if you're unfamiliar, this is a 7-inning game. In these 4-game series, they can play the two teams 34 innings scheduled as opposed to the 36. So typically the fourth and final game is a 7-inning game, which this one is.
This young stocky gentleman built like a catcher. A little strong fire hydrant. On top of the plate.
Watching that one run off of it.
We worked into a 3-0 count.
Noel walks him on 4 pitches. So a couple of walks and a couple of strikeouts for someone who entered the day with 61 more strikeouts than he had walks.
Now, I like Roos's approach at the plate. He's on top of it. He's like, give me a pitch to hit. He didn't get it, so take first.
Klez homered 3 times in yesterday's doubleheader. He has 22 on the year to tie the conference single season record. And the catcher, Roos, has taken second.
Is that the first stolen base of the afternoon for Azusa Pacific?
For Azusa Pacific, it is, yes. Point Loma had
the double steal.
Had the double steal in the first. But.
Oh, he went first move. Yeah, he'll take that bag all day when you go first move.
It's interesting that they chose to still attack Klez, who in foul ground is retired. Oh, Dunlap had it pop out of his glove, didn't he?
Yeah.
He
had it. His hand, lost it in the transfer. That was one great play right there. He covered a lot of territory right there.
Now batting, the third baseman, number 9.
Which is also good because the first baseman wanted no parts of that ball.
Dunlap made a lot of ground up really in his last couple of steps.
Yes, he did.
That ball was, it looked to be out of his reach. But Point Loma gets away with that. With a base open, you could have easily just put Klez on.
That worked out a little bit better.
Although Tovaline did homer in the first game, and it is his older brother that shares the single season home run record with Klez. 22 of them.
All right, you saw how Noel stopped when the umpire called timeout.
Sure did.
In professional ball, they tell him to throw the ball so they don't hurt themselves. That's a chance that he could have hurt himself by stopping a sudden movement like that. So pitchers, when that happens, just throw the ball.
Even if you just throw it back to the screen, just keep the momentum going. Keep your motion.
Yes.
They appealed, and that was a strike. So it's nothing and one. Here you go, Roos stole second, so Noel gives him a look. There's a one hopper that's through the infield, and Roos is going to wind third. Here comes the throw from Balliet, which isn't close to on time, and it's the Cougars who strike first for the second straight game.
Yeah, he got that spark plug at the bottom of the lineup. He took a four-pitch walk, stole second, scored on a base hit. Like, everybody's doing their part on that Azusa Pacific team.
In the first game, it was really Point Loma that manufactured runs.
Yes, it was. Well, at least later on in the game.
Yes.
And that swing right there, look, he's out in front, but the hand stayed back, and he was able to just flip it out there to right field. Got an RBI out of it. You can really hear them riling up out in their dugout. And I hear them with the same chants that I heard yesterday. When a pitcher is, you know, a little flustered up there.
Yep.
They'll start yelling, rattle, rattle, rattle. And trust me, as a coach, you don't want to hear that stuff. It's like, calm down, play with some class. They don't know what class is. They know what a classroom is, but they don't know what class is. And so we'll hear, rattle, throw it harder. It's like, why are we trying to agitate the other team? Why don't we just beat them with our bats, our defense, and our pitching?
Hits and runs.
Exactly.
And to be honest, I don't think Noel is rattled.
Oh, not at all.
He walked Roos, who stole second. We got Klez out. You know, it's just manufactured runs here for the Cougars. So one of them.
Which makes you wonder why he's thrown over three times. I don't think Osvaldo is the most fleet of foot.
Shallow center field for Preece, who has to increase his gallop a bit towards the end. And it comes to a close with a hit and a run, and the Cougars are on the board here.
Speed. Power. This trophy is not given, it must be earned. The NCAA Division II Baseball Championship. June 1st through 8th at the USA Baseball National Training Complex in Cary. Visit ncaa.com/tickets to get your tickets today.
As a student athlete in college, I first got involved with the NCAA at the national level. It was through the Student Athlete Advisory Committee, SAC, gave me an opportunity to advocate on behalf of all student athletes to affect change and to make an impact. The NCAA is giving the student athlete a platform to voice their concerns and to be able to advocate for what's going to affect their well-being. The policies that are being put in place are speaking towards academics, they're speaking towards well-being, they're speaking towards fairness, creating a culture so that the student athletes have the best experiences possible.
Over at the promotions table.
It's the life living out here in the San Diego area. Beautiful spot for a ball game as well. Cougars trying to split this doubleheader today and win the series in the process. Maybe even get all the way to the D2 Baseball Championship. University of Mount Olive, town of Cary, will host it. 2019 NCAA Division II Baseball Championship, June 1 through June 8th at the USA Baseball National Training Complex. That's in Cary, North Carolina, and tickets are available now at ncaa.com. So here was our MVP of game one, hitting at the bottom of the lineup. Palos had quite a day for himself.
Still has a keen eye up there at the plate. He's looking for his pitch to drive. And the patience that he had up there, he took strike one. Hey, I don't know what this guy looks like today, so let's make him throw some pitches.
Palos gets under this one. Still in fair ground. Herrera makes the catch. Hey, this one away.
They finally got him out.
Both nine holes in the first game were pretty pivotal in the game. Dykstra had a nice day at the bottom of the lineup. Dykstra's not in the starting lineup for this game, too, for Azusa Pacific, the nephew of Lenny Dykstra.
And Kearney is really moving that ball around, you know, keeping the guys off balance. You know, he has good stuff on the mound, good fastball, and he knows what he's doing with it.
Just turned 21 a couple of weeks ago.
Make you wonder what he did for his 21st birthday.
Practiced, probably did a bullpen session. No celebrating at all. Azusa Pacific has been pretty readily shifting their defenses, and right now the hole is on the left side. Big swing and a miss there for Takata to even the count.
Well, Takata's been turning and burning on everything today, hitting that ball in between first and second, hitting it down the right field line. So there wouldn't be any real reason to play him other than pull.
They're going to give him that call on the outside corner.
Well, the umpire's been a little generous with his zone, unlike the first umpire who had more of a hitter's strike zone. This umpire here has more of a pitcher's zone.
He's thinking it's a little cool here, too. Kearney's got another strikeout, and there's two away in the third. Second strikeout for Declan.
And one thing I wanted to mention, that he's 6-0, had 13 appearances, 8 games started, where in the first game, the starting pitcher, Trip Reversa, only that was his first ever start being a reliever, and also a son of a former big league coach, Joe Reversa, who was my teammate and roommate in the Cardinal organization. And Joe's been, he was a bullpen coach, now he's a scout for the Toronto Blue Jays, and he's a baseball lifer as well as I am, and it was great seeing him today. Did not put one and one together.
Cazares out to short. Goudreau makes the play. Down in order go the Sea Lions in the third of this 7-inning game. It is 1-0 through three.
Fans interested in working.
It was in undergrad at Point Loma. I remember a professor saying, if you want to change the world, business is the way to go.
I currently help support over 14.
Prior to grad school, I just kind of focused on like what's going to bring me to the next level. What's going to get me into the executive suite on the top floor in the program. I've learned the best leaders are the ones that serve. The reason why I work at the company I do now is because an alumni reached out, took his time to foster me, to build me, to mentor me. I want to leave a legacy that invests in people.
There's a mountain here before me, and I'm gonna climb it with strength not my own. And he's gonna meet me where the mountain beats me and carry me through, and carry me through, yeah.
Azusa Pacific leads it 1-0 as we move to the top half of the fourth. For all the latest news, stats, rankings, and more, check NCAA.com. NCAA.com is the official online home for all 25 NCAA Division II championships and is also the site to go to when the Division II announcement is made. We'll have a selection show for the NCAA tournament. They always do a nice job with that, streaming on NCAA.com. By the way, that dog is one of a few that are in attendance today. Gomez on the first pitch. Skies one out to Balliet. One away in the fourth.
That was a good swing right there. He got smooth under that ball right there.
First baseman, number 5, Tito Robles.
Here's the pitch. He's ready. He got that off the end. But that swing right there, that's the swing that you want to have right there as a hitter. And let this be a note to the coaches that are out there who have a tendency to tell guys what they're doing when they're at the plate. Like right there, I would have told Gomez, hey, stay right there. You just missed it. Some coaches are like, hey, you got under it. You look like you was trying to hit a home run. Now you're putting thought into the hitter's head, which if you were to tell him, hey, you just missed it, the hitter is like, yeah, you know what? I just felt like I may have just done this a little bit. But when you're giving them, when you're volunteering information when it's not needed, sometimes that hurts the player more so than helps them.
Well, we're here in San Diego, right? Tony Gwynn made his name out here, one of the best hitters in the game. He hit, what, 330 for his career? So every now and then he had a good swing and produced an out.
Yep.
That's the way it goes. Sometimes good swings also produce hard hit singles, like the freshman Robles with one out in the fourth.
I'm telling you, I really like Robles as a ball player, you know.
I know
the scouts are here to see Klaz and here to see Prize, but also you have guys that are freshmen like this young gentleman here. Look at him. He's in a great hitting position, hand straight to the ball. That ball knuckled. He hit that ball too hard.
There is such a thing, huh?
Yes, there is.
No, you're going to take us back to that exit velocity conversation again, aren't you?
No, look, he knocked the rotation out of the ball.
He did.
That's a strong young man who's only going to get stronger and better.
Went to St. John Bosco. It's a high school that
produces
athletes.
Yes, they do.
Now Stroud takes ball one.
He had a great at bat in the last game and also this one here. You know, he walked. Makes the pitcher work. I like whenever you see guys that take pitches, you know, you always hear, hey, you're making the pitcher work. I wasn't that guy. I was the guy that get up there and as soon as you throw anything that's remotely close to the zone, I'm coming out of my shoes. I'm not trying to be up there to be your best friend. I'm trying to be your enemy.
You're up there to hit.
Yeah, because Lord knows he's going to be fist pumping and stuff when he gets me out.
You mind that? So long as you're not showing somebody up, but just having some fun, showing some emotion.
You want my total honesty? I don't care either way. Bat flip, fist pump, do whatever. Because, one, it's really not showing up the other team. It's showing excitement for your team for getting an out, a big out. You remember in 2004 with the Boston Red Sox, they did this double finger pointing at each other?
Yep.
Well, I was hitting against Kurt Laskanik, and I had two strikes on me, and he throws a slider, and I swung over for strike three to end the game. And when I brought my head up, he pointed at the catcher like that, and the catcher did it back to him. I was like, oh, man, they got me. And I walked back to the dugout. That's a long walk from home plate to the dugout in Boston and Fenway.
But you knew that they weren't showing you up. It was a celebration between pitcher and catcher.
Exactly. But there's so many people that get caught up in that, you showed me up. Well, if I hit a ball 580 feet, I am not sprinting out of the box like a infield single. I'm going to admire it. Now, if it's a wall scraper, different story. I'm trying to get to second base. And then as for the bat flip, I wasn't a bat flip kind of guy. But if anybody goes and watch any of the Caribbean World Series or just watch the Dominican League or the Venezuelan League, it's all about getting the fan interaction, and those guys don't get mad at you show me up.
It happens all the time.
Yeah, you know, it's a celebration.
Now batting, the shortstop.
How about this one here from Noel?
Two, Michael Goudreau.
Okay, that's a product of a nice pitch and a generous umpire. It's a little bit of both.
Noel will take it. He's got two away here in the top half of the fourth. And he once again will check on Robles.
But you know how sometimes hitters can be beggars. Right now, I would be begging. Like, hey, that ball was inside, knowing good and well it was right down the middle. Or caught that inside part of the plate. That was a nice little cut on that ball.
Got to work them just up to that line and not cross. Robles finally breaks. The throw is...
Oh, my.
On the money.
Wow, he had a good jump, too. I want to see his release.
We will, as soon as we get you back to Carroll B. Land Stadium. And we'll show it to you right now, at least the break.
Where did Darian Sylvester play junior college baseball?
Interesting slide for Robles. The inning is over. We go to the bottom of the fourth.
I'm a PacWest athlete, so I get to travel all over the West Coast. I'm a PacWest athlete,
so I can excel in the classroom. I'm a PacWest athlete because I want
to win championships.
With students from countries all over the world.
From Australia to England,
we are diverse.
With majors ranging from business to fashion design.
Medicine to animation, we are scholars.
With players from every sport, from baseball to tennis.
Cross country to soccer to golf.
We are athletes.
In NCAA Division II, student-athletes leave a lasting impression on their communities. That's because Division II student-athletes want to make a difference and truly be part of their surrounding communities. Through community engagement, thousands of student-athletes from various backgrounds interact with community members who view them as role models. This interaction leaves a positive and perhaps even life-changing impression on all those involved. In Division II, we rise to the opportunity and make community engagement ours.
So he was our player of the game in game number one of this doubleheader. Paulos, for what he did at the bottom of the lineup offensively. And he just throws a dart to catch Robles stealing to end the top of the fourth.
Fielder number 21, Micah Breeze.
You know, I thought for a moment that because the throw was about chest high, I thought maybe Robles would get in. But then you watch that slide on the back end, and he slowed himself.
Yes, he did. He started tippy-toeing right before he got into the sliding zone. And right there, Priest gets hit.
Second time today. He wore one in game one, although in game one it was a
now batting,
like 50-mile-an-hour curve.
23, Justin Ledgerwood.
You know, if I was a scout, I'd be disappointed because I didn't get to see adequate amount of swings from this young man. He's fine with that.
Been hit twice. He's been intentionally passed. Here's Justin Ledgerwood.
We know he played football in high school. What position do you think he played?
I'll go linebacker.
Yeah, he looked like he can crack some skulls.
He's listed at 6'3", 200. He grounds one head high over there to third. Tobolin for one. Around the horn they go. There's two away here in the bottom of the fourth.
When you have a pitcher who throws a two-seam fastball right there, when you're swinging with your bottom hand and you're going around the ball, he topped it and then went right to the third baseman. So his swing was designed to hit into a double play with a pitcher throwing that ball the way he's throwing it.
Two away in the fourth, and that's just the 46th pitch for Kearney.
That was another strong hack from Mr. O'Toole right there.
Every time that line flashes up, his season numbers, the way he's been swinging it today, I'm surprised his home run count is zero. Nothing in two.
Yeah, I was real surprised too, especially after seeing that ball go as far as it did, especially how the wind was just started to shift.
Mm-hmm.
Like, had he hit that a minute prior, would have had a grand slam.
Would have changed the complexion of that one. He skies this thing up on the infield. This will be Choir. And a 1-2-3 inning in the fourth. We go to the fifth of this 7-inning game.
The American dream to me as an immigrant means having the opportunities that my parents didn't have. Being the first one in my family to graduate, it meant everything my parents sacrificed for me to get to this point. It was paying off.
Estoy muy orgulloso de Michael por haberse graduado de colegio.
My path to a college degree would have been completely different had I not had a scholarship. It would just relieve a lot of the financial burden.
From court to court and lane to lane, under the lights or under the sun, no one delivers Division II sports like NCAA.com. The center of D2 is inside the NCAA.com hub, with exclusive highlights of every sport and live broadcasts of every Division II championship, found nowhere else. Make NCAA.com yours, the home of Division II college sports.
It's a tough life for our crew, got out here a day early to get some of these unbelievable scenics out here in San Diego. It's 1-0 as we move to the fifth. Division II provides more than 120,000 student-athletes the opportunity to compete at a high level of scholarship athletics while excelling in the classroom and through community engagement. Learn more about the D2 philosophy, ncaa.org/D2. With the former big leaguer, Dimitri Young, Darren Goldwater. We got Kevin Shank, Jeff Graham, and TJ McGinnis making us look good back in the truck.
I look good without them.
Well,
what are you talking about?
Senior Captain Goudreau to start off the fifth.
You know, right at the break, we had a scout come over here, and I was talking to him about Kearney, how his ball's moving late and stuff. And he was saying that, you know, you have guys here that are coming to watch Noel pitch as well. And they said that the other guy, Kearney, who's throwing, you know, he's opening up eyeballs. So, once again, students, you do not have to go D1 to be seen. All you have to do is be able to play. If you get out there and play, there's a chance for you to be seen. So there are scouts here. There are scouts that will be at NAIA, Division III.
All over.
If you can play, they will find you, especially in today's social media and being able to get to remote places and having showcases for guys to go to nowadays. You know, you will be seen. So don't get caught up in, oh, I'm not going D1, where there are plenty of schools that have baseball programs, very great baseball programs at that. So don't pigeonhole yourself in going D1 or bust, or else you're going to be the one that's going to Dodger game like, man, I used to play with that guy. I was better than him. Well, one guy kept playing, one guy quit. That's how that happens.
Noel's been good. He just happens to be trailing in this 1-0. You know, to that point, I saw a stat around the NFL draft. There are more Hall of Famers in the NFL that went undrafted than there are Hall of Famers that were the number one pick.
I believe that.
That was an interesting one.
Ooh, straight
two
pass.
And two now.
Well, when you're out here and trying to find talent, you know, you're gonna look and see how they're throwing, what their ball's doing, how the batters are reacting to it. And scouts are, when they're doing amateur scouting, they're looking for a reason to like you, a reason to sign you, a reason for you to be in their organization. Now, on the pro side, when they're getting ready to do trades and whatnot, they're looking for a reason not to get you. They're like, hey, we like this guy here in Double A. Well, we don't like him because he strikes out too much.
Right, what are all the negatives?
Yes.
What can we present that could be negative to us if this deal goes through?
Right. Right here, you're looking for positives. Both pitchers are working both sides of the plate, moving the ball around, keeping guys off balance, have control of their pitches.
Here's the payoff to Choir. And Noel lost him. You know, one other little anecdote to that. I was doing a lacrosse game recently.
Now batting,
and
catcher number eight.
One of the best players, it was the face-off guy. So one of the most important players for lacrosse, possession-wise. And we're talking about recruiting and how he got him on campus to this Division II. He said, really, I was up looking at somebody else. But this guy caught my eye. And we brought him in, and no one else really wanted him. And now he's become one of the better face-off guys in Division II. I mean, that's the way it goes. Just stay positive, and maybe your chance will come.
And, you know, I talk to parents all the time with their high school kids. You know, they want to play, when they play travel ball, they want to be on premier teams, elite teams. It's like, you might get lost in the shuffle. Why don't you play on a team that's okay, they're good. But also, that play in the same tournaments as those teams that are highly talented, that has all the talent, because what happens, just like we talked about, they're there to watch somebody, but hey, there's two or three guys that caught my eye. And you can be one, two or three of those guys right there. So all you got to do is go out there and play, be on a team that you're going to play every day.
Ball and a strike on Roos. Nicely placed. Noel whirls and fires him out. There's two away.
And there you go, right there. He's doing the small stuff to help the team. I'm talking about Roos right there. After taking a walk and still in second and scoring, right there, he moves the runner over. Puts him in a position to have Cole Klez come up there and do possibly tie the, well, not tie the game, they're already leading, get a comfortable two-run lead.
A homer would give him 23 on the year, which would break the PacWest record. He is currently tied for second in all of Division II with his 22.
You wouldn't think he's pressing, would you?
Well, he hasn't gotten one out today, but it hasn't really been favorable. He got under this one again.
I would have to say he is pressing a little bit.
Well, Cazares puts it away, and the inning is over. We're through four and a half of this seven-inning affair. One run is on the board.
Baseball for me just kind of was the glue that kept my family together, I feel like. I was able to come here and get my triple major, as well as play a super high level of baseball against some of the best players in the country. There's a lot of options here in Division II with a lot of great ball players and a lot of great people, and they make sure that they give you every opportunity to succeed on and off the field.
Before the house, before the office, the late nights and new bosses. Before the last hugs, the wins and the losses. Before building the team, before building yourself. The rise and grinds, all day, every day. Before the letter, before the dream, there was a kid who loved to play. If you have the talent and dedication to succeed in school and in sports, we'll provide the opportunity.
Pretty clean looking home half right there that Declan Kearney is firing against. A run on three hits for Azusa Pacific, nothing on the board for Point Loma. As we go to the bottom half of the fifth. Remember, just a seven inning game here is the final game of this four game series.
Now batting, third baseman number five, Colby Kamishiro.
And you better believe that this game means something to Azusa Pacific for two reasons. Number one, they want to bounce back from the earlier loss today, which was just their third in their last 28 games. Number two, you don't want to go into the NCAA tournament off back-to-back losses. And then there's number three, if Azusa Pacific loses this game, they lose the season series to Point Loma. They win it, and the team split it at 4-4.
Oh,
this ball,
he put a charge on that ball.
It is gone.
Oh, wow. There goes the no-hitter, and there goes the shutout.
Okay, FP Santangelo.
I'm a foot taller than him.
Canichero ties the game with his opposite field shot, and it's one all.
Wow, that was a great piece of hitting right there. So I guess we found out what a jet stream is.
It was about 10 minutes ago that I looked at you, Dimitri, and I said, yeah, the wind isn't blowing as hard now.
Nope.
So we are tied here in the fifth. That's out of play.
Ooh, that ball was up. Up and he's throwing away, and that swing is beautiful. Into the ocean, splash.
He was hitless in the opener today, and that one's going to go a long way here for the Sea Lions.
Did we get a reading on the launch angle on that home run right there?
It's 35 degrees. The exit velo was about 106.
That ball didn't get too high, did it?
No.
So I'm saying launch angle was 21 degrees.
Okay.
Fahrenheit.
You still like the exit velo, though?
I like the exit velo. I think okay. That was legit. That ball really, that exploded off the bat.
That was a good-looking compact swing. Look out. Balliet bends his knees out of the way of that one. It's 2-2. When I said that FP Santangelo, I think you knew what I meant. The analyst for the Washington Nationals, and a tip of the cap to Moises Alou, who was one of the biggest influences for FP's career. First a chopper out here to short, and Goudreau handles that.
Way to hustle down that line, kid.
So every single time the
now batting
team gets a hit, their first of the game, he'll say, there goes the no-hitter, as a tip of his cap to Moises Alou. Every single game.
Every single game, the first hit.
Yeah. That's how much Nationals I watch. Here's Casey Dunlap, and he's on board.
Well, that's the last thing that you need when after you lose the no-hitter in the shutout is to put somebody on base. Uh-oh. Is that man again? Mr. Palos?
It is.
Yeah, he has really stepped up today for his Sea Lion team.
I feel like Dunlap's made a living on base today. He was 1-for-3 in the first. Scored and he drove one in. This is the second time on base today. Grounded into a fielder's choice and he takes off here as this ball twists away from Klez, but he's there in center even though he was behind the right fielder Stroud.
I think Paolo's got that one off the end of the bat, because that was a great swing like he's been swinging all day. So if anything, he was just tat out in front. No big deal.
Designated hitter, number 12, Travis Takata.
I would tell him to stay right there as a hitter. Hey, go throw someone else out, kid.
Exactly. I just thought it was interesting there with Klez and Stroud going for it. For Klez to make the play with Stroud cutting in front of him.
Yeah, if Stroud would have hurt Cole, I think he would have been released out of his scholarship.
I think that would have been it for the day. Top of the lineup here in Takata. Remember, just a 7-inning game. Worth that reminder here over and over again. This is the start of the third trip through the Sea Lions order, and first time they've gotten to Kearney today, who had not given up a hit through four innings.
Now, what we've seen out of Takata today, he's a dead pull hitter, so I kind of find it interesting that they're still throwing that ball middle in, enough for him to be able to get some sort of extension and turn on it.
The defense is playing as such. Second base is well over into the hole. He's definitely closer to first than he is second.
And the umpire that is positioned as second is the second base rover.
That's right.
He's the extra defender in softball that was just brought in.
There's a tremendous hole up the middle. Wow.
Sea Lions were able to exploit that a couple of times in game one today. He tries to go the other way. This is out of play.
I think he sees that hole too, and he's going to try and hit that hole, especially being a leadoff hitter. You know, guys that don't have pop usually have great bat control. That's why pepper is so important to play for young hitters. Be able to see where you're making contact and using your hands and not so much body.
Got him. Takata doesn't like it.
Can't argue, he's been there the entire game.
But now we're tied through five innings on this shot from Canisero.
Beautiful compact swing.
One all as we head to the sixth.
My path to a college degree would have been completely different had I not run Division II cross country for the University of Mount Olive. Having an athletic and academic scholarship was key for my success. And our coaches were really helpful with balancing out my academics and athletics. I decided to attend graduate school because I wanted to become an athletic director. Receiving the postgraduate scholarship through the NCAA provided me with the flexibility to choose the school that I wanted. So now I know that I can accomplish any goal that I set for myself.
In NCAA Division II, community engagement is an initiative at all 25 national championships because student-athletes want to give back while competing for a national title. Over the course of the year, Division II student-athletes have an opportunity to leave a lasting impression in local communities throughout the country. Whether Division II student-athletes are volunteering at hospitals, schools, after-school care programs, foster homes, or retirement villages, they make a difference in the lives of others. In Division II, we rise to the opportunity and make community engagement ours.
Here's what we're looking at as we head to the sixth inning of this seven-inning game. Azusa Pacific got the first run in the third. It was answered by the solo shot moments ago. Both pitchers have been impressive. Noel has those three walks, but it's been a well-pitched game. It's been an enjoyable one to watch. With Demetri Young, I'm Darren Goldwater. Point Loma trying to split this four-game series by sweeping today's doubleheader. And if Point Loma wins it, they'll feel better about their odds of getting an at-large berth, although no guarantee. And they will also take the season series, 5-3.
That was a good pitch to take right there. You know, if anybody's going to change the score of the game, it's going to be this guy right here. He's been tattooing the ball all day today. Playing some interesting defense at third base with that one double play in last game. Got the RBI single. You know, got to appreciate his approach to the plate and the power that he displays to all fields.
He is the second of the Tovalin brothers to play at Azusa Pacific, and he smacks one on the ground, knocked down there by Canisero. So he's got a homer, and now this defensive play, and that begins the sixth.
Now batting, the left fielder, number 16, Griffin Herrera.
That's where it hit him. That's what your belly's there for, though. Get in front of the ball.
I don't think he has a belly. I think he has an eight-pack. He looks strong.
It's the same thing that they say about me.
Who's they?
The eight pack. Everyone. You just haven't seen. It's Griffin Herrera now. The two games yesterday in the doubleheader were both blowouts in favor of the Cougars, but it was also at their place. This one's heading back towards the track. You know, it might be a good thing this is the last game at this park this year. Yeah, that buzzer is
sounding like it's hurting to alert either the folks over at the track or over on the tennis courts that a foul ball is coming their way. This one sounded pretty good, but it is hit directly at Ballier. Couple steps in now, two down.
It's been a tough day for Herrera today.
Now batting, designated hitter number 25, Justin Gomez.
Now we're about to see a professional hitter up here in the amateur ranks.
He could be a professional very soon. Gomez homered yesterday. He's been on a tear. He's looked very good today. He was a preseason first team West region for the Baseball Writers of America. He's been a first team Pac West guy for the last 3 years.
That was a great swing right there. Short, compact, especially against the lefty. And when I used to struggle on the left side, I'm going into when I used to slump, I would have a coach who threw left-handed throw to me, because as you see with Gomez, he's able to stay close. As a hitter, sometimes as a left-handed hitter seeing a right-handed pitcher, you have a tendency to cheat, and that front shoulder would fly up to the pitches away. So I would start hitting against the lefty to keep that front side closed so I'm able to stay through the ball and actually use more hands than body.
I would think lefty-lefty would be more of the tendency to fly open that front shoulder.
It is. It definitely is. But I didn't hit against lefties all that often as a lefty.
That's true.
I did it probably three times in my career, and they're against thumb and lefties. Chris Hammonds. What was the guy that pitched till he was 100? Jamie Moyer. Because he throws the ball so slow, and on the right side, I'm like every kid that never seen a breaking ball. Oh, I can't stay back. And that was a great at bat by Gomez, walking right there. Professional hitter in college.
The way Tito Robles has played today, you would think he'll give himself an opportunity down the line. Only a freshman right now.
Well, the way that this young man is swinging, I like the way he swings. He's going to get better. He's going to get more powerful, especially when he gets in that weight room and really start putting on some muscle. You know, because it's not very common to see freshmen starting. You'll see him come in and get a spot start here or there. But, I mean, he's come in and really earned himself a spot.
Noel trying to get himself through the sixth in this tie game, and that should do it. There's Cazares. A walk is the only base runner in the inning. Bottom of the sixth we go with this seven-inning game in your D2 showcase.
My dad was a soccer coach and bought this little book bag. I could sit in the book bag, like facing backwards and with like my legs out. So I'd be in his book bag when my dad coaches and the ball's going around. I'm like kicking at the ball in the back. And my dad's like, we have a prodigy. So he put me into soccer and it just progressed from there. The catalyst was the opportunity to play soccer at a Division II school. On my team, I thrive to work as hard as I can. I mean, whatever you do on the field, there's a positive correlation to whatever else you do, be it personal relationships, homework, the way you carry yourself. I've changed since I got to King University. It's really helped me to develop as a leader. I think it's honestly the best thing that's ever happened.
That is the temperature right now. There are many folks in this stadium that are bundled up pretty heavily. Wind coming in off the water as we move to the bottom half of the sixth. Connect with D2 Athletics on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Follow along, join the conversation as the NCAA promotes national champions in 25 D2 sports.
Are we in Southern California? They look bundled up.
Number 10, Miguel.
It doesn't take long, whether you're from an area or you move there. If you are accustomed to cold weather and you move to a warm weather place, your blood thins in no time. I would know. I grew up in Maryland, went to school in Pennsylvania, and then moved down south. And 50 is cold now. Here's a quick out to begin the bottom half of the sixth.
So a good pitch to swing at. Just didn't get enough of it.
Number 21, Micah.
Remember, this is a seven-inning game. All of the nine-inning typical game rules would apply if the game remains tied through seven. Kearney didn't give up a hit through four, gave up a solo home run last inning. That's what tied the game.
Look who's hitting.
Here is Preece. It's one of the first times he's really been able to unleash a swing all day.
Yes, and right now would be a perfect time for Point Loma and for him to get home run number 19.
Top 10 in the Division II ranks with those 18. One of the better players in Point Loma history here, Micah Preece, takes ball one.
A good-looking young man up there at the plate.
Hit a three-run homer yesterday. That was in game two of the doubleheader. Chased one above the letters. It's one and two.
Calm young man up there at the plate. When you're a good hitter, it doesn't matter what the count is. You can hit in any count. He's not the one that's been chasing pitches today.
Nope. He's been hit twice. But both headliners, the ones who are pretty much your sure bet All-Americans, Klez and Preece, they haven't made the large impacts that they've made throughout the year in either one of these games today so far.
That's the word, huh? So far.
Klez is in center now. He was the right fielder to begin the first game. Six-four junior takes ball three.
Has that long, slender build. Room to put on another 15-pound of muscle. Especially if he going to the next level, a.k.a. professional ball.
He's been a three-year starter here, so he is draft eligible.
And I'm pretty sure he'll like to play a little more ball before getting in that draft. And
there's one in the zone for him. Roped line drive and a one-out single. Go-ahead run aboard in the bottom of the sixth.
That doesn't look like a face that's happy that he just got a single. Because that was a pitch that he could have put out of the ballpark. Happy that he got the single, mad that he didn't get an extra base hit.
Got good plate coverage there. That ball a little down away, too.
Yeah, he got some good extension and stayed through that ball nicely.
Here's Ledgerwood now, and he grounds one to the backhand of Toveline. There's one, two. They've gone around the horn twice today, and the sixth inning is over. Scheduled seven-inning affair goes to the seventh, tied at one on your Division II showcase.
We can stop to make sure someone is okay.
Get in the way and disrupt the situation.
Notify an authority.
Or walk them home safely.
We can change the language around rape.
We can make campuses safer for our teammates, our friends,
and our classmates.
We cannot be bystanders.
Taking action isn't always easy, but it's on us
to intervene.
Because we can. Learn more and take the pledge at itsonus.org.
Being a champion takes more than skill, more than endless drills, more than using your head. Being a champion takes the heart to give it your all, the agility to thrive from any angle, and the relentless drive to be the best. Welcome to Division II, where the pursuit is yours to create, and the question isn't, can you do it? It's, will you?
Volleyball becoming more and more popular in the collegiate ranks. I would imagine the volleyball team out here would be a pretty solid team, but I'm not sure.
Definitely solid. When you live near the beach.
Zach Knoll out for the seventh. Any trouble he has seen, he has bounced back from. By the time he was touched up in the third,
now batting,
it was a one-out walk that came around to score. Roos stole second, and then he came around on Tovaline's RBI. Sixth man in the order starts it off here for Azusa Pacific. Top half of the seventh, and a game scheduled for seven innings. And what is the final couple of innings here of the regular season? The PacWest doesn't have a conference tournament, which is why there's been so much talk from us today about the NCAA tournament, because plenty of leagues around the country do have tournaments, so they can help their resumes, whereas this is it for these two. Stroud drives one here into left center. Pree's got a nice jump on it, but won't catch up. It is off the wall, and it is a leadoff double here for Stroud.
What a swing. I really like this swing. Ever since he came in, had nice patience, had great balance, hands in position.
He didn't miss this one getting out by much.
Boy, he put a swing behind that. Right now, you got to move the runner over to third base by any means necessary.
You'd think this would be the guy up at the plate to do it.
I wouldn't be surprised to see him bunt right here. Bunt the ball to either side, just not back to the pitcher.
Defense is basically straight away. Strike one.
Great idea, bad result.
Wouldn't shock me to see him try it again.
Oh, yeah, he's definitely doing it again.
I mean, they haven't played the small ball like Point Loma has today because their team is just simply built differently.
Which is something that they probably need to work on going into the playoffs here. You know, when you have these one-run games like this, you know, you can't manufacture a three-run homer.
Stroud over at second. Now the throw back behind him. They got him.
No.
He slipped down and is out at third. Paulos again. I tell you what, it looked like the daylight play was on back there before the pitch.
Yes, and he wound up pitching.
Watch Cazares here. He's there.
Got off and saw it and slipped on a banana peel.
Yeah, talk about bad timing. And he knows it.
And you know that was a strike, too, so Goodrow did not square up the bunt, or he pulled the bunt back. Ooh. Oh, and he pulled back, and it was a strike, and
Those are two missed opportunities in one play, I think, for Azusa Pacific. Because, number one, yeah, he could have laid that bunt down. Number two, with Cazares going over behind the base runner to the bag, if Goudreau's swinging away, there's nobody on the left side of the field.
Nobody.
Instead, the bases are empty in this tie game, and now there's two outs.
You know what? I think that the reason he got picked off at second was because that ball, if I'm at second base and I see that ball looks like a strike, I'm getting off. And then he saw him pull back, and I'll probably call it a strike. He's like, oh, he's trying to get back, and he slipped, and now it's two outs, nobody on.
Choir over top of an off-speed pitch.
The choir hasn't been looking good today against the left-handed pitchers.
Yeah, I mean, even if he didn't slip, if he went headlong back to second, he'd have been out.
Oh, he was 100% out.
That's low for ball one.
Now, the one thing I noticed with Choir here hitting, he hasn't been able to hit the curveball at all. And the reason being, what I'm seeing, he's trying to pull.
He did pull it through the right side.
He left the ball, up right there. He left it up and in for him to pull. But what I was going to get at was,
now batting.
The way that you don't get fooled is if you to look away. Not necessarily I'm going to hit the ball the other way, but if you're looking away, you're able to see the pitch longer, and then you see the pitch either in or out of the zone. And when you see the pitch out of the zone, obviously you're going to lay off. But when you're looking to pull, your first move is to cheat. And what I mean by cheating is your shoulder's going to fly open to try and catch up to that pitch.
Justin James is out with a conversation that includes the entire infield. Remember, this is scheduled to be a seven-inning game here. So one out to get in the inning. He's going to leave Noel out there for Aaron Roos, who's been a thorn in his side a little bit.
You talking about a pest? A gnat? A thorn in his side? Yeah, he brings a lot of energy, this guy.
...20-year-old who played sparingly last year. He's got the only run of the game for Azusa Pacific. He takes an off-speed pitch for strike one. Looking ahead to the bottom half of the seventh, it'll be 5, 6, and 7 for the Sea Lions.
Got a walk, sack, bunt, run, stolen bag. Got that hole between first and second wide open. Also a hole between third and shortstop. Third baseman's up and on the line, and the shortstop is playing back up the middle.
So you're saying there's places to put the ball here for Roos?
Oh, a whole lot of real estate. Just a matter of him getting his pitch and him being able to execute.
This one's out of play.
Ooh.
That was pretty close to us. They must go through a ton of baseballs out here. It's not like you can send the guys out to shag the homers after BP.
I'm pretty sure there's somebody around here that's designated to do that job. Probably an aspiring mountain climber.
Look how far Roos has choked up here on the 0-2.
Well, if anybody knows the zone, it's him. Oh, well, hey, that might be the kid's dad umpiring.
Here's the 1-2 to Roos now.
Oh. the more I watch this young man have to play, he reminds me of an old teammate of mine that played in Detroit by the name of Brandon Inge. Same build, same structure, same little facial expression. And Brandon was also a catcher.
Another 1-2 offering. Ooh. This time he gets him.
Turned that pitch over.
Nice. Five hits, one run. Through seven to the home half of the final inning we go.
Opportunity to me means doing the things that will make you a better future. I always dreamed of graduating from college. So being the first one in my family to graduate, it meant everything my parents sacrificed was paying off. Having an athletic scholarship for the University of Mount Olive was key for my success. But I had the opportunity to not only get an education, but be able to develop as an individual.
In NCAA Division II, student-athletes leave a lasting impression on their communities. That's because Division II student-athletes want to make a difference and truly be part of their surrounding communities. Through community engagement, thousands of student-athletes from various backgrounds interact with community members who view them as role models. This interaction leaves a positive and perhaps even life-changing impression on all those involved. In Division II, we rise to the opportunity and make community engagement ours.
Justin James trying to finish off this sweep of the second doubleheader in 2 days against Azusa Pacific. The Cougars grabbed the doubleheader yesterday pretty convincingly in both games. But this shows you really the depth of the PacWest Conference. Granted, Point Loma is in third, and they won't finish lower than third. But the fact that the team that left fielder had won 25 of their last 27 games coming in, 10th ranked team in the country. These guys are fighting right with them. Bottom seven of a scheduled seven-inning game, and O'Toole slices this pitch out of play. Including the earlier game today, this is what the standings look like right now. So Point Loma won't fall back to four. But the importance of those standings, well, they pale in the importance of the region standings. This one's on the infield grass. The shortstop takes over, and it is Goudreau for the first out.
Well, those were two swings that I think he was overswinging on that one, trying to end it. And as a hitter, what you want to do is to stay with your approach. And whatever happens, happens. But once you start trying to let me end it with a bomb, you're going outside of your game plan, and thus you probably won't do what you aspire to do.
Here are the regional rankings that you just saw there. That's how the six-team West region will be decided. However those region standings shake out after conference tournaments are done. Kaneshiro had the first hit of the day. It was a solo home run that tied the game his last time up, and he rips one here into left, but that's foul.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, that was no launch angle on that at all. That was a line drive swing with a little bit of elevation and that nice, strong human strength that he has.
They're not getting that ball back, just in case you're wondering. That would have been ball one.
Yeah, when you're feeling good up there at the plate, and he's seeing that ball well. He is seeing it well. See if he can muster up one more swing to hopefully get them to the playoffs.
Been a good career for him. He was third team all Pac West as a freshman and sophomore. He's been all academic 3 years. He's reached in 9 of his last 10, the last game being the exception. Does he hold off? He did.
Yes.
So he still has some life here. 2-2 leading off the bottom of the seventh with one out. Second batter of the seventh.
Well, I know Kearney knows that he's onto his fastball, so he's got to find a way to trick him.
That one almost got him. But it's been a good at-bat here from 0-2. He's worked it back full. Point Loma scores. They walk it off here. Ballier would be next. He's made a couple of nice plays in the field today. It's a heck of an at-bat. Great winning run is aboard with one out.
You know what? That's probably a good idea. Based on what he did his last at-bat and the way that he was swinging on his fastballs that at-bat.
It's a long look down for the signs here with one away in the seventh.
That was a good take right there. Third baseman is off quite a bit.
See if Kearney can get himself through seven here. That'll twist out of play. Belly has got one homer on the year.
Want to take a stab at where he hit it?
Gonna go ahead and guess it was out to right. Canichero off first. Ballier over the head of the leaping Robles. First and second with one down.
Now batting the second baseman, number two, Casey Dunlap.
Ooh, the pitch was going down and he got the hands to the ball. That was a very handsy hit right there. Took his hands to the ball. Great piece of hitting.
Should point out that there was a defensive change for Azusa Pacific. Dykstra's in the game in center, and that moved Klez out to right.
So, Stroud, thank you for your service today. Great job, young man.
So if you're Casey Dunlap here, what are you thinking, number one? And number two, that's Palos who will hit behind him. And I think the decision right now for Justin James is whether or not he's going to put a pinch runner in there. And that is what he's done.
Okay, that makes sense right there.
So Canichero is lifted.
And Canicero, great job.
Nico Anderson will run for him.
Nice homer.
Number nine, Nico.
Great walk.
So the last game that Canicero plays in his home ballpark, he knows that he broke up a no-hitter with a solo shot. And here's a new left fielder coming into the game as well, Pavlison. So lots of changes right now. Nico Anderson, who's been put into run for Point Loma. There's a sophomore from right here in San Diego. This is a spot for Azusa Pacific now that we referenced just a little while ago. You don't want to go into the NCAA tournament off back-to-back losses, getting swept in a doubleheader. Especially as hot as this team was.
You don't have to look much farther than their record in their 27 games prior to this. The numbers that they put up, and even yesterday's doubleheader, convincing wins. They hit 8 home runs yesterday as a team. But right now, Point Loma is threatening to...
I'm looking to hit the ball to the right side. Oh, why the second baseman is so close to the... Well, obviously. Somewhat be around the base runner.
Dunlap does go to the right side, but this is hanging up there for Klez. He's not going to test him.
That was probably a good move.
Especially when you see that throw come in.
Now batting.
And remember, it's Klez out there,
number 7,
and not Stroud. So now it's up to Palos, who has been so good today.
Yeah, he's been coming through left and right with his bat, with his defense. Just all around great game today. And what a better way to finish it off with a base knock right here to win it.
Put one in the gap, this thing.
I want one right to the guy, and there's a play at the plate, but we're going to have to watch it on the monitor.
Well outside from Kearney. So again, Nico Anderson is running over at second. It's Ballier at first. And the graduate chance for Palos at the plate. Went after one. It's 1-1.
That was a nice aggressive swing right there.
He hasn't gotten cheated at all. He's played well defensively. He's been great at the bottom of the lineup.
Yeah, what a pleasant surprise hitting ninth.
He's got his average up to 316 with his day today. Nicely done with the backhand there from Roos.
Has nice patience up there.
Scheduled 7-inning game. Base hit could win it here with Nico Anderson over at second. Kearney's 2-1. Is upstairs.
Forced to throw the fastball right here, risk loading up the bases.
If you're Palos, one spot, one pitch?
Oh, yeah, definitely. We'll see what they're thinking, though, with this pitch coming up.
Little bit low. So the winning run advances down to third as the bases are loaded for Takata.
Now batting. Designated hitter, number 12, Travis Takata.
Takata has struggled against Kearney today.
Had a second baseman playing in the hole. You have the middle wide open.
He did have a couple of hits and an RBI in the first game of the doubleheader. Nico Anderson, the winning run, third, as Takata shoots it foul.
Seeing that backside dipping just a hair. And when that backside dips, the bat head drags. So he keeps a strong backside, the bat's going to get to the zone a lot quicker.
He has worn out that bat. Did you see that? There's almost no paint left on it. Takata slices one to left and deep.
And that
it is
the game
over.
That is the game right there.
Takata walks off Azusa Pacific.
The great Mustachio with the game winner.
What a way for these 10 seniors to go out in their last ever home game.
That is unbelievable right there. Great game. pitch by both Noel and Kearney. Point Loma, they proved a point right there. Hey, they absolutely positively needed these two games here to be in the conversation of continuing to play this season.
Final game of the regular season, no conference tournament. You want to help out your resume? How about knocking off the 10th ranked team in the country twice in one day?
That is absolutely incredible. You know what? Like I said earlier, once baseball begins, once the game begins, just in all levels, game becomes exciting. And that was exciting two ball games.
That's exactly what you want to see out of one right there. Well pitched, well played. Walk off there for Takata. To make it yours, player of the game, I say we give it to Travis Takata. Division II gives student athletes the unique opportunity to compete in the classroom, on the field, in their community, for their causes, most importantly on their terms. It's NCAA Division II baseball. Make it yours. And Travis Takata did just that. After Paulo's walk to load the bases, Takata ended the conversation with this swing.
That's the first time they hit ball to the other side of the field all day today, and it proved to be exactly what they needed. Walk off.
Gotta believe they've got a pretty good shot now at an NCAA berth, but we'll have to wait and see. Azusa Pacific has to right the ship after these two losses as they head in to the West Regional. Fun day out here at the most scenic ballpark in America on the campus of Point Loma Nazarene University.
Total pitches.
They sweep today's doubleheader and have won the season series against Azusa Pacific. For our entire crew, my partner Dimitri Young, I'm Darren Goldwater. We say so long for your Division II National Showcase. Point Loma sweeps the doubleheader from Azusa Pacific.
Peace.